Shalom. Today we're moving on in understanding Hebrew verb structure. We are still working around different conjugations, the format of the verb, the vowels, the prefixes, suffixes, and infixes will tell us what is the tense, what is the person, and what is the binyan. Working in the perfect or the past tense, this will mean a finished action. I did, I was doing, I had been doing. Today we're going to work with the Niphal binyan. Remember that in all the perfect tenses, the endings are always the same, regardless of the binyan. We're going to work with this root, this full root, because this verb, to be at war, tends to be in Niphal, so we can find a lot of examples for it. The Niphal perfect tense always starts with the nun, and it will have all the standard endings. So here we see the conjugation for lacham, to be at war, nilchamti, nilchamta, nilchamt, nilcham, nilchama, nilchamnu, nilchamtem, nilchamten, nilchamu, nilchamu. So here we have some examples starting in 1 Samuel 29:8. So David is with Achish and he has been fighting with him. But the Philistine leaders are not in favor of having David there because they understand that he is an enemy to them. And so Achish is going to send him away. And David asks this rhetorical question, haven't I been with you? Haven't I done great for you? And didn't I go and fight against your enemies? V'nilchamti bo'oyvei Adoni. In 1 Samuel 15:18, Saul has not done what he was commanded to do, and Samuel is now reproving him. And he said, look, I sent you over there, and did I not tell you to make war against those people and wipe them out? He says, you were to make war, v'nilchamta bo ad kalotam otam. You were to make war against them until you wiped them out. So Samuel is talking to Saul. He says, you would have made the war. In Numbers 21:26, talking about the city of Cheshbon, that it was the city of Sichon, the king of the Amorites, and he had fought against the king of Melech Moab. So this is who nilcham ba Melech Moab. He fought, third person singular. In Deuteronomy 1:41, Moses is recounting the many things that happened in the desert. They were supposed to go up and fight, but they were afraid to go up and fight. Then they decided they had sinned, and they said, oh, okay, we'll go up and fight. So we see, anachnu na'ale, we will go up, v'nilchamnu, and we will fight. It's conjugated in the perfect tense, but the vav makes it conversive for the future. In 1 Samuel 4:9, the ark has come into the Philistine battleground. The Philistines are very afraid, and so their leaders are encouraging them, be men and fight. Again, it's a vav conversive. We see it conjugated in the past tense, but it will be for the future tense. V'hayitem la'anashim v'nilchamtem. All y'all be men and fight. In 2 Chronicles 17, Jehoshaphat is a king. Interestingly, it says that his heart was devoted to the ways of Yahweh. He removed the high places, and he was teaching the book of the law all around the towns of Judah. And then in verse 10, it says, the fear of Yahweh fell on all the kingdoms of the land. And so they did not fight. They did not fight with Jehoshaphat. Lo nilchamu. We're going to look at this root, shava, which we've looked at previously. Also, not our concept of a passive form, but it does appear in Niphal, to swear or to take an oath. The verb does end in ayin, but it doesn't affect the conjugation at all as it does in some other tenses and binyanim. In Genesis 22:16, after Abraham has taken Isaac up the hill and been willing to sacrifice him, God comes to him and he says, I swear by myself, Vayomer bi nishbati, I have sworn. In Exodus 32:13, Moses is interceding on behalf of the people And he's telling God, remember the forefathers that you swore to give to them this land, that you would multiply their seed like the stars of the heaven. So he says, Asher nishbata lahem bach, which you swore by your own self. In Genesis 50, verse 24, Joseph is speaking to his brothers. He says, it's my time to die, but God will come back, and he's going to take you out of this land and bring you to the land he swore to Abraham, Isaac, and Yaakov. So we see this form, nishba. Now, the present tense masculine form sounds exactly the same. The difference is between the kamatz and the patach. So they sound quite the same. There's just a very slight variation of vowel for the participle and the past. But this is the past tense. He promised the land to the forefathers. In Judges 21:7, we see the plural form. We swore. This is at the end of the long, horrible story in Judges, where the Levite kills his concubine and cuts her up, and they make a promise that they're not going to give any of their daughters to the Israelites, or how can they provide wives for them, for the Benjamites. And so it says, we took this oath, nishbanu. In Joshua 6:22, Joshua is talking to the two spies that have come out of Rahab's house, and they have made a promise to her to rescue her during the siege. And so it says, Ka'asher nishbatem la, as you have sworn to her, all y'all, both spies. In Genesis 21:31, Abraham and Abimelech are making a treaty. They are swearing an oath. And so we see this form, they swore, the two of them, at Be'er Sheva, Kisham Nishba'u Shnehem. We're going to look at this verb asa because it does end in hey. There's not a lot of examples, but we will see some typical hey behavior. In 2 Chronicles 35:18, they had found the book of the law in the wall of the temple, and Josiah made this amazing Passover that hadn't been observed since the days of Samuel the prophet. And so this na'asa is the third person singular masculine. It was done. In this case, up until this time, lo na'asa Pesach kamohu b'Yisrael. There wasn't done a Passover like the one that they're doing here with Josiah. You remember that in the third person feminine singular perfect tense, for verbs that end in hey, we lose the hey and we get a tav, and this is what we see here. Talking about Achitophel, that he had brought some advice, and he sees that it was not followed. So they're using the verb asa to do. Sa is feminine, it's atzato. His advice, it's feminine, lo na'asta. It wasn't done. So we see that that tav is in there, because it's a third person, feminine singular, she did something. Now we do have a particular case when a verb begins with yud, and we had a similar situation, verbs beginning with yud, when we had the he feel participle that the yud changes to a vav. So we have the same thing in the perfect tense, in the niphal. We also have it in the participle tense, which I didn't cover, but I'll give you some examples after I give you the perfect tense. In Jeremiah 6:8, he is warning the people. Actually, the word of Yehovah is warning the people that he is going to turn away from them and make the land desolate, and it will not be dwelt in. So Yeshev can have the meaning of to dwell. This is that the land will be dwelt in. It's a passive form, and we see this Eretz lo nashava. So it's a third person feminine past tense. It has that hey ending. Remember that Eretz is feminine. In Ezekiel 26:19, another warning for the city of Tyre, that the city will become desolate and again no longer inhabited. And so the phrase is, like the cities which are not inhabited. So we see ke'arim and the verb, they are not dwelled in, noshavu. It's a third person perfect plural. From the same chapter, we see talking about the city which is destroyed, avadit, and the city noshevet mi yamim. It is inhabited. It's a present tense, noshevet. We can recognize the present tense ending. If it were in the pot, it would be yoshevet. Here it's noshevet. It's a niphal. Miyamim interpreted to be people of the sea, sailors. And in Ezekiel 12:20, we see the plural. You can see that it's a participle, plural, noshvot. Again, talking about he'arim, the cities which are inhabited. So until next time, tassim et ha'inayim al hashamayim, keep your eye on the sky, your redemption draweth nigh. Shalom.